Welcome back. We just had a really fierce match between JJ and Howie, but now the last match of the day of day two at TGL Tavern Tales will be between Stan Sivka and Tessin. With me, Raven and Ecop. Aw, such a sweet little guy. Right?
I know. I'm super sweet.
Yeah, so you guys will be casting this match. What can you tell me so far about those guys? Raven.
Yeah, well, I know Tessin actually feels really good about the tournament so far. Obviously, he's been performing very well, so that helps. But he feels like he's very prepared. I think he can take on anyone. He's quite happy with his lineup and has actually been putting, just like all the players, actually a lot of preparation to the pick and ban phase, which I think has been the main story of this tournament so far overall.
Yep. Yeah, Tessin, of course, the player right now in the tournament with the best score overall. After all, he won his group, going 3-1, 3-1.
Yeah.
And then he beat, who was it, Xixo?
It was 3-1 as well.
3-0 even.
3-0, yeah. Okay.
So, like a score of 9-2, that's insane in this kind of stacked environment.
Yeah, that's true. Let's see if Stan Sivka will go with the flow and play Priest again. But let's see if the lineup from Tessin will actually allow him to do that. Because it was a specific response to Life Coach lineup. So we'll see if that's the case. And unfortunately, it's not. By the way, you have two different socks.
Yeah. Who's got time to pair socks, Lofa? Not me, I'm a busy guy.
I know, you don't even eat breakfast, man.
Well, there you go, don't have time for it. Just power through.
Okay, let's talk about the bans. Two druids are banned. That's the first ban from both players. And then the first picks, Warrior and Shaman. So for Tessin, it's actually the Shaman. For Stan Sivka, it's the Warrior. Did we see the Warrior from Stan Sivka?
I don't think so, but I'm pretty sure it's Control. Have you seen the listing up?
Pretty sure it's Dragon Warrior. I guess it's the same lineup as JJ is running, right?
So might be.
They pretty much played the same decks this whole time.
And yeah, that makes sense.
We have the deck that's available to us. I can check it later on, but yeah, it's definitely Dragon Warrior, I would say.
Okay, then let's see the second wave of the bans from Tessin. It was the Mage and the Shaman. Kind of obvious when you face a Freeze Mage and you don't want to have that against you, right? So I like those bans. From Sivka, we have Warrior. Nothing new here, right? And Mage as well. But if I recall correctly, Tessin was playing the Tempo Mage, the more aggressive version of the lineup. So the third wave, Sivka, Rogue and Warlock, while Tessin, Hunter and Warlock. So we'll not see any discard lock this in this game, which is actually good for either of those, for both of those players, because the discard lock seems to be a decent choice against the Hunter, decent choice against the Shaman as well, to take control of the board pretty quickly with three minions, an example, right?
Yeah, we know Tessin actually just really likes Hunter, I think, overall. I think his lineup, unless something goes terribly wrong in the pick and ban phase, he's seemed to be really favoring Hunter, and after 3-0 versus 6-0 with it, then why not? But I think it's a class he plays a lot in the past, so even though we've talked about the strategies and how flexible you need to be in terms of pick and ban, you also kind of want to play the decks you feel best at as well, so you know, and build your strategy around that. So I think we see that coming out from Tessin.
Yep, that's a good point. But at the same time, I think we are developing the game, the tournament environment, in the way that every single player needs to be efficient with every single class. It's not the time where, an example, Hoya had this problem while playing at Gfinity, when he said that he shouldn't play the patron deck because he wasn't obviously good at it, and he just wanted to stick with the classes that he knows, right? In this environment, you actually need to be efficient with every single deck. So mulligans are on the screen, Warrior against Paladin, and it seems like Dragon Warrior. Ecop was right about it.
1 point to Ecop. Damn, I'll have to catch up.
1 point to checking up the deck list.
So it's a good opening hand, because there's an Alexstrasza champion and another dragon. So at least it's a beat down from the beginning. You can even coin it out on turn one if you want to. While the Paladin... okay, let's say like that. Anyway, I'm going to leave you guys to it. Anything can Paladin happen against Dragon Warrior?
Thank you, Lothar. And yeah, looks pretty good for Stan Sivka already. I mean, the keep we saw with the Alexstrasza champion and Azure Drake is actually really common, because you rely on the curve being like low enough or having enough low drop minions in Dragon Warrior. So that, you know, keeping a 5-drop isn't too much of an issue, especially with the power of Alexstrasza's champion early on. And, you know, we can see he has got the Frothing Berserker as well to help fill that curve out.
Yeah, for sure. Definitely a very strong curve from Stan Sivka here. He can play the champion on turn 2, the Frothing on turn 3, and the 5-drop on turn 4 with the coin, so definitely an amazing curve. And that's what Dragon Warrior obviously strives on, having the amazing curve. And the better the curve, the better the chances of winning. Tessin, on the other hand, will be looking to get all the perfect solutions. It's hard to do it if you don't have the coin and the extra card that comes along, that comes along with it.
Yeah, so it looks... So Sifka's got the choice now between just dropping the Fire Dragon, which seems pretty terrible because the Loot Hoarder just kills it, or you can go for the Alexstrasza's Champion. And if you do go for that, do you actually like to trade with the Loot Hoarder here, or do you want to just let the Paladin trade for you? Because you're pretty confident it's going to happen, right?
Yeah.
There's not a lot on 3 that's going to deal with this Alexstrasza's Champion to the extent where the Loot Hoarder gets more value.
Definitely. Nothing that the Paladin can do here can punish this Alexstrasza's Champion. True Silver Champion is still a turn away from happening. There are no buffs, of course, in the Paladin deck. In the Urlok Paladin deck, so yeah, this Alexstrasza's Champion will just be able to deal with either the Loot Hoarder or the Murloc Warleader and buff up the Frothing Berserker at the same time.
Yeah, and I feel that when you play Dragon Warrior specifically, but many other decks as well, versus this kind of Paladin, you really just want to go like all out and be hyper aggressive if your hand allows it, and just hope that they don't have the correct answers. Because one of the sort of stumbling blocks for Murloc Paladin is they have a lot of great answers, but they sometimes struggle with the card draw to get to them. And the second they don't have the correct answer, they can fall behind very quickly and then have to make very inefficient turns in terms of healing, maybe with Forbidden Healing as well.
Yeah, definitely a lot of great answers, but the problem basically, and therefore the inconsistency that comes with that, is that a lot of those great answers require 2 cards to pull it off. So yeah, Paladin can struggle in that regard.
Yep, and nothing too flashy here. The trade into the Loot Hoarder means that the War Leader still doesn't have a clean trade into the Frothing, and the Alexstrasza's Champion is still on the board. But now, can actually trade them both away, because the Blue-Gear Warrior will be buffed to 4 attack because of the War Leader. Clear up the Frothing Berserker, and then, you know, if you want to, you can War Leader straight into the 3-1 just to slow the game down.
Yeah, this is definitely an amazing pickup for Tessin right there. Stansivka, of course, could have played around it, it would have the Loot Hoarder and Bugle Warrior would have killed off the Frothing Berserker anyway. So I guess it didn't really matter in hindsight. So definitely this play that potentially leaves him with another minion in this situation was the right play to go for. So well played by Stansivka.
But what do you think about this?
This is interesting. I'm not sure exactly about this.
I think the issue, or at least the thought pattern for Tessin, was probably I want to leave something on the board.
Yeah.
Because if you just do the Murloc trades, then you let the Dragon Warrior just have the initiative again and can build the board, then you have to respond. And he does have 2 Aldor Peacekeepers, though, so I feel like they would be pretty good responses to the follow-up minions.
Yeah, but then again, what do you have to think about? What do you expect on 4 mana, right? There could be the Korkron Elite, which gets handled easily by the Pyromancer, and
you know the coins in hand, though.
Yeah, of course, the coin 5-drop is actually more likely to happen, but still, it's fine because like how do you use Pyromancer otherwise right now? It was kind of that card right now, and the Bluegill Warrior, because it has charge, can catch your opponent off guard as well, and it's also like a easier solution because it's just 1 card to some minions, at least like Fairy Drag, for example, rather than having to keep the Pyromancer in case you ever draw like an equality to belong with it.
Yeah, so we saw Sifka end up going for Finley to regenerate the hero power. Definitely armoring up is Dragon Warrior is not a way you're going to win this matchup at all. So I really like that play going for the aggressive line. He could have coined out the Corruptor, but chose to just go a little bit wider on the board and like I said, sort of fish for that hero power. We are going to see the Blue-Gear Warrior now actually take down the Fairy Dragon, as you predicted.
Yep.
Is the follow-up going to be Doomsayer? It looks like it.
Yeah, definitely Doomsayer is a strong turn here, considering that, we saw Stansivka use the coin, which gives Tessin the tell that he does plan on actually curving out with like a 5-drop. And he could have... there's no 5-drop that deals with his Doomsayer in this situation. So now he denies Stansivka a complete turn, pretty much.
Yeah, the only silver lining, I guess, for Stansivka here is he can't really play a minion, but his opponent only has 3 cards as well, so there's not really been too cycle heavy on Tessin. Obviously he's going to draw into 4th now, Probably looking for some kind of cycle. And Barnes is actually a great pickup here because it's Ivory Knight would have felt bad considering he's already used a Forbidden Healing. Ivory Knight to potentially heal for a maximum of 2 is pretty horrible. Oh. And he just gets Ragnaros, which, you know what? Fine. Heal for 2. Create a minion that kind of has to be dealt with, even though it's a 1-1. You can't really ignore it. And also just go a bit wider on the board, which is nice because otherwise it would have been either Ivory Knight to heal for 2 and draw a card, yeah, or just like Aldor. And there's a lot of great Aldor targets.
Of course,
in Dragon Warrior.
There were better potential targets for the Barnes. But I guess you're not really too unhappy about Ragnaros Lightlord. Sure, Tyrone would have been better, for example.
Yeah, but I think the key is there's a lot worse targets as well. Like for the Barnes, you're mainly looking for either Murlocs or Tyrion, yeah, most of the time. But there's also like Ivory Knights. I mean, we can see there's the one Ivory Knight and the Aldors, but they're also, you know, like terrible ones to come out as like pure 1-1s. At least the Ragnaros actually, you know, has some form of value one way or another. Still looks like Stan Sifka is going to be in the driving seat though, because he has a, you know, plenty of big threats to pull out, and he's already seen a Pyro get used as well. So
yeah, great solution right here though with the True Sliver Champion. He doesn't even care about taking the 5 damage from the Corruptor, because he does have the Ragnaros still on board, healing him up to full once again. Free, yeah, value is free.
Yep, really getting the value out of the Ragnaros there. Pretty decent Barnes overall, but still feel like Tassim will need to get into some more cycles. As I said, Sifka can just very consistently now just start dropping down pretty reasonable threats, even with the True Silver Champion there.
Yeah, Tassim will need to get some card draw at some point to keep up in terms of card advantage that Stan Sifka is generating right now, with the thanks to the Azur Drake as well in part. Sure, he does have the board with the True Sliver Champion, and he does have some decent solutions against bigger minions that are coming up. However, he needs some more to get him over the edge.
Yeah, and there is a plan to play Ragnaros next turn, I imagine. It's kind of a difficult one to deal with for the Murloc Paladin, because not too many Murloc lists are actually running Kodos at all to, you know, combine with Aldor or Humility. And also, just using an Aldor doesn't really do anything against Ragnaros due to the style of the card and the effect as well. So, you know, I think Sifka's still in a good position here, and Acolyte of Pain does get picked up though. So at least that's something. Not great, because other than combining with a Pyro, it's very difficult for the Paladin to, you know, guarantee procs.
Yeah, but
on that card,
then again, you have the Aldor Peacekeeper to kind of ensure that.
That's true.
Yeah, you can shrink down a big minion and then attack into it with Acolyte, guaranteeing yourself.
You just have the risky turn, don't you, of like playing it. You need to get it on the board first.
Sure.
Okay, Avenging Wrath, Colosseum, one of my favorite Paladin cards, and just good old Blessing of Might. What do you actually like here?
Enter the Colosseum is actually fine if your opponent ever goes wide. It has obviously a higher chance of clearing the board in that case rather than Avenging Wrath. And the fun part about this is, of course, Stan Sifka will not know what kind of spell it is. It could be anything that costs 4, but it could also be anything that costs more.
Yeah, I think the key for me with the Colosseum is that he's got 2 Aldors. So if something huge comes down, he can actually, you know, if there's more than one minion on the warrior side of the board, he can actually Aldor one of them that he actually wants to kill to 1, and then play Colosseum later on and just clear off the board. It's not going to be quite the same now because there's only Ragnaros down, so you can't quite pull off that trick yet, as Ragnaros smacks him in the face for 8. Ooh.
No, look at
quality
that.
Just in time.
Yeah, I wouldn't be too surprised to see the equality come down, but although it's like, it doesn't really matter though. The Ragnaros right now with board this big, it's not going to do much generally. Like, that's obviously one of the ways to play around Ragnaros. You just put a bunch of minions on the board that you don't care about.
That's true. It's just with access to, you know, like, pretty decent removal, say, Ghoul Weapon, then that really narrows it down. And if you take much more damage from Ragnaros, we can see that actually Tessin's not got any healing available to him now. So it's a little bit risky, but I suppose if there's any more minions played, then Enter the Colosseum deals with Ragnaros next turn anyway.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, there was no way equality was good in that case. Sure, mm-hmm. It seems appealing like you have, oh yeah, such a big minion, and you have you have that 1-1 to trade into.
But then if the Dragon Warrior goes wide on the board, then you kind of screwed,
like,
right?
You cannot dish out equalities like that. It's like one of your, it's actually your only hard reset that you have in your deck. Mm-hmm. So. Yeah, Stan Sifka has so much potential card advantage at his disposal, especially now with the Curator as well. He was never going to run out of cards to play. And yeah, it's all about just yeah, this game will revolve pretty much all around Tessin being able to deal with all the cards that Sanzuka will be able to play.
Yeah, what do you think about the Corcron use of into the Acolytes of the Axe there?
You see, I actually like it quite a bit, considering that... I mean, of course, sure, you could use the Axe, but you want to use the Axe to clear off bigger minions that are more threatening to your ward. And, of course, you want to kill the Acolyte that turn as well, to deny him the double draw.
Yep. The Ragnaros does hit a 1-1 there, so, you know, doing the job for Tessin, I guess, going wide on the board was worth it. And now, Colosseum feels okay, because you still now have the Equality and the Consecrate. But also, you're feeling okay just popping Ragnaros, but the fear is that your opponent's Ragnaros just snipes it, so that kind of feels terrible.
Yeah, the Colosseum seems awkward here. Yeah, you kind of want, you cannot consecrate. You want to keep the consecrate for equality, most likely. Options. I guess you do go for the enter the Colosseum.
Yeah, there's not too many other options. He could follow up with Aldor Peacekeeper on the one that survives.
Yeah, but you don't. But
that's his second Aldor, so you know there's a lot of bigger targets from the Dragon Warrior that could deal with that, and that would just save the Ivory Knight. And I don't know how worth saving the Ivory Knight is this turn.
Yeah, it's not worth saving at all. It dies, just dies to Warwicks anyway, and you can keep the Elder Peacekeeper for the Elder Peacekeeper for bigger minions like Dragonet Crusher or Onyxia that's just been drawn.
Yeah, and you just saw into the Colosseum as well. So are you even feeling confident about just slamming Onyxia?
Well, I mean, Colosseum was the extra card that you don't really play around anyway most of the time. Unless you know, of course, what it is exactly. But yeah, Onyxia. I mean, Stasivka still will have to consider all the spells that are in the deck anyway.
Yeah, of course. I just meant purely because he used the card he got from Ivory Knight, and it was a board clear to a certain extent. So at least, you know, that option has gone. The Ivory Knight card isn't there as well. Because it was only ever going to be that or, I think, Avenging Wrath, the only two six drops, right?
And Tessin must be really happy about having picked up the second Consecration, which does give him the additional sense of security that he will still have a hard reset with the Equality Consecration if Stansivka's board keeps getting out of control like this.
Yeah, but now this is going to be the Dragonet Crusher number one at 9-9. But as you said, there is the hard reset with the Equality Con. Is this the turn that you have to go?
Yeah, there's no doubt in my mind.
You can even follow it with Doomsayer now as well.
Exactly, yeah. There's no doubt in my mind that we will see the Equality reset here. Doomsayer to set up a clean board, because most likely you will not play anything into the Doomsayer. And then Ragnaros on an empty board, always good to see it.
Yeah, and requires a very specific answer, pretty much an execute from the Warrior. There is the ping, which is frustrating because it's a guaranteed activator for the execute, but it's as good as it's realistically going to get. Even gets to push a little bit of damage as well. I was just going to trade and save the card.
Oh, this is interesting.
This is probably better, right?
Yeah.
Because, the ping's already there, so the leaving the execute proc up changes nothing because it's just, okay, I won one and Ixion.
Yeah,
sure.
Of course, yeah. But yeah, of course, it's also, you have to consider Doomsayer would have been really nice because the menagerie is for guests, you would have the initiative with the Ragnaros, and I mean, you still do, I guess, but it's weird. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean,
like, when do you ever set up Doomsayer? That's my question, right?
Yeah, but I guess the idea here is this is the same, but it would have been a turn later, and there wouldn't have been a 1-1 on the board. Does that matter that much? I don't know. It allows him to draw an additional card, I guess.
Yeah.
To be in this situation, but with one more card.
It's just going to be so hard to apply this Doomsayer now. Mm-hmm. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. You don't want to play it on a board with a rag either. So I'm not sure. Unless he gets the second reset, of course. Unless he gets the second equality, he can follow it up with a Doomsayer once again. Mm-hmm. We'll see how it goes. Of course, what do you actually want to heal here? The rag, I guess, right? Are you afraid of taking damage here?
I think you'd prefer the rag, mainly because there just aren't enough minions on the board at 22 for the Frothing Berserker to just kill you. You know, I'll do like an obscene amount of damage. And if the Berserker goes face, then the rag's staying alive unless it's an execute. So I think you do want the rag up to full. As we said, the execute activator is always there with ping, but we can see that Sifka doesn't actually have it yet, so we might actually see a Zyordrake here.
Yeah, we haven't seen a single execute yet. So with so many cards having Stansifka having drawn so many cards, the odds of actually drawing a execute here with it as a Drake right now are incredibly high.
Mm-hmm.
Relatively high.
Yeah.
Just say.
Yeah, I think I'd always start with the Zyordrake. Like you said, it just cycles into a potential easy removal for the Ragnaros. And worst case, you have good follow-up with Face Monkey Ping, or even just Nuzoth's First Mate.
Yeah, he does have the opportunity to still clear the Rag right now anyway. There is, all he needs to do is like run the Onyxia into the 1-1, for example, and then like ping the Rag, and that's enough damage with the Frothing then.
What now? Fly, Polly!
Is there a... Okay, that changed a little bit. I was going to say, is there ever a time where you play Face Monkey, ping Rag, and then just go Face with Frothing? Purely because you've seen... You've already seen inequality, right?
I didn't quite get it right now.
Okay. So... Oh. Tyrion off the top.
I mean, that was definitely a very good clear by Stansifka there. Clearing the Murloc and the Ragnaros. Only leaving Tessin with a measly 1-1, but of course the Tyrion can come down here and that could be really impactful. Consecration, unfortunately, not able to clear the entire board, but the Tyrone, as I like to call him, is going to put a stop to this aggression.
Yep, it's going to be pretty good. As at the moment, how it stands, it's going to require the weapon and both minions to go into the Tyrion, which feels pretty good.
Yeah, you feel fairly confident that that's exactly what's going to happen as Tessin, because you didn't see an execute, which would have been amazing, of course, for Stansifka last turn. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, a top deck execute is not likely. It's less likely than anything else being top decked in this scenario.
Yep. And there is, you know, even though that it requires quite a lot and takes a lot of damage, actually, puts Sifka to 10. There hasn't even been too many. How many Murlocs have been played this game? There's one War Leader, definitely.
I think there was two War Leaders and
one Blue Girl. Yeah. So you're not really super scared of chain anything, especially because there's only two cards in the Paladin hand, although he has held on to that Consecrate for quite a while. So there could be a read that it's actually anything, but as I said, like, you know, one double buffed War Leader isn't really going to completely ruin your day at the moment. Is he going to choose not to trade here with a double taunt? I think so.
Yeah,
like this, I think.
Exactly what's happening.
Solemn Vigil is actually a good pickup. Any form of cycle would have been great, or like instant cycle. Loot Hoarder, bit slow. But Solemn Vigil going to get some work done, especially because you can at least trade a couple of minions away. Can you trade the 1-1 to get a cheaper Solemn? Is 3 versus 4 that big of a difference? I don't think so. I don't think there's anything in the deck that would require 7 exactly. I guess it's not going to be too much use for the 1-1 though.
Alright, pick it up a Forbidden Healing. That's going to be useful later on.
He's going to float with Doomsayer? Yeah, like this.
Consecration Doomsayer. Definitely nice. On board, he does not have the kill on the Doomsayer, but now with the Execute finally being picked up, he can handle this board very easily, without losing his minions.
Yeah, and can still drop the Draconic Crusher as well, so this is looking pretty reasonable now. That execute pickup at last. You could look at this and say, oh, it's very fortunate to pick up the execute.
Yeah,
but
he was
we're quite
it.
Deep in the game now, and there's some awkward situations where an execute would have actually been really nice. So, you know, about time I guess for Stansifka to get that card now, so not too bad at all.
Yeah, indeed, he was waiting for that for a long time. Unfortunately now, because he wanted to preserve the board, he was not able to enable this Draconic Crusher to a 9-9. Which I guess wouldn't have been possible anyway, even if we went like for the trade the other way around.
We're not going to see the anything come out.
Oh,
even Finley.
Finley.
We forgot about Finley.
That's true.
Yeah, it feels kind of bad to use Ashbringer on the one health there, but obviously you definitely want the Murloc to trade into the Crusher to remove it. And suddenly, there we go. Yeah, that's just going to be game. He can't actually clear up enough damage, especially with the Finley being an extra body, actually came in as a positive there.
Yeah, definitely. And Stansifka, of course, knows there's no way he can win from this point onward. Most of his resources have been spent, and Paladin still had ways to go. He's obviously still the second Anyfin available at some point. Yeah, even if Stansifka manages to handle all the Murlocs.
Yeah, it's going to be. It's only a matter of time, right? And Stansifka couldn't actually put any more pressure on because the Crusher was killed off. So, a bit of a rough one there, Stansifka. Quite a long game, considering, you know, Dragon Warrior normally either gets the job done very quickly or not all a lot of the time. But yeah, it looks like Tessen's going to go 1-0 up with the Paladin.
Yeah, continuing his run of dominance right now. Let's see if he can continue further on in this series or if Tansivka can make the comeback here.
Yeah, and yet again, it's just another player who's definitely no pushover in the form of Tansivka. And Tessen's looking pretty good. What do you think is going to be picked? It's going to be the Rogue. So Rogue has a pretty decent matchup versus the Murloc Paladin, I feel.
Yeah, that is correct. Although it's quite deceptive, I would say, since Paladin, if Paladin gathers the right answers against the minions of the Rogue, Paladin can definitely, it can also even be in a favored position, because if you manage to handle all those mid game minions very well, then eventually all you have to play around is like a little bit of a burst, and that usually you can handle it very easily with all the heal that you have in your deck.
Yeah, I think as well, like what Rogue needs to do is pile on enough pressure just to force the equalities and then go into the big guys to finish up the game and make cards like Gadget Zan really awkward.
So we see it right here in Stansivka's hand, actually. There's a bunch of those mid-game minions. And the common trend we see with all those minions is that there are 4 health, right? Mm-hmm. So you have the Gadgets and you have the Tomb Pillager, you have the Azure Drakes, all at 4 health. And then pretty much the cards that Paladin is looking for is to clear is either the True Sliver, or as we can see in this hand as well, the Blue Gill with the Murloc War Leader is also a very smooth way to clear one minion.
Yeah, it's a really nice quick sort of 5 mana removal and leaves a 3/3 on the board and sort of banks the Murloc into the old anything. So, that's not bad at all. And you see Acolyte come down now. Just a pretty steady start there. Acolyte can be a bit of a pain to deal with for Rogue. There's no other than like spell power backstab. There's no super clean ways to deal with it. And now gets the War Leader down, so doesn't care too much about the potential combo of War Leader and Bluga Warrior later on, which is interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you have to consider that the combo is only available for 5 mana, and Tomb Pillager is coming down right now, so you have to have this Murloc War Leader set up in anticipation of the Tomb Pillager.
Yeah, and it's exactly going to work out pretty well.
Sure, he just drew the True Sliver, which would have been a good alternative.
But he'd already set himself
up. As long as you have this combo available to you, you have to go for it. Otherwise, your Murloc War Leader dies, and the Blue War is going to be less impactful. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's always a worry though that if you play it before if you feel the need to really answer the turn 4 Tomb Pillager, because as we can see, like Gadget Zan and Azure Drake are turn 5 drops and 6 drop respectively, and the problem is if you play the War Leader on its own and then just backstab and the weapon hit, and then suddenly you're in a bit of a problem. But it worked out pretty well for Tessen overall. He's got a decent sized board, and now Sifk has to decide where he wants to, or if he wants to throw this backstab out, because he has now drawn into Van Cleef, and backstab is a great tool to buff Van Cleef with very minimal effort from the Rogue.
Yeah, but then again, if he goes for the backstab that's been improved by the spell damage minion, then yeah, he does have a higher chance that the spell damage minion will survive.
Yep. Okay, so the True Sliver is going to be equipped now. Again, like you said, being able to deal 4 damage versus Rogue is actually very nice and deals with almost all the minions available, so it's looking pretty good. Fan of Knives, not really a great pickup for Sifka here. Definitely don't want to fan an Acolyte of Pain unless you want to make someone overdraw.
Yeah, definitely not. it's sometimes even like really good to, when you see your opponent is starving on cards, it's sometimes a really good move to even sap an Acolyte. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we're in the position where this is actually relevant, especially when you consider there are going to be Ragnaros Lightlord and Tyrion, which some Murloc Paladins don't play. And Tessen, of course, plays it, and the sap is so important to have against Tyrion.
Yep, and the Azure Drake does get pretty much fed to this True Silver, but that's another resource gone, right? There's one True Silver gone already, and the Bluegill, but you know what? Tessen's actually doing a pretty decent job of getting these Murlocs out early, so he only needs one more Murloc for a full initial anything, and Rogue has no real defense versus the anything at all, so this is super early. One of the problems you can have in this matchup, I feel, is when you don't have the Murlocs, it's very difficult to set up a win condition because you don't really have any great way, because Rogue is very tricky and can, like you said, sap off your other big targets. It means that you don't really have another way to finish the game. But like I said, already Tessin putting together a combo.
In this kind of matchup, you are never unhappy about having too many Murlocs in your opening hand, right? Like you said, you want to have that anything enabled for maximum value as soon as possible. And of course, by playing those Murlocs, especially the War Leader, they are also a big threat at times, because Rogue has to dedicate resources to handle them, which also gives you enough time to draw into, like, set anything or other answers that you need against concealed boards, for example, Equality Pyromancer or whatever.
Yeah,
whatever
and,
you need.
And even this early means that... So one of the tactics you can kind of do as Rogue as well is if a late War Leader comes out, so where 10 mana is available, you can actually just sap the War Leader to delay the anything, because obviously anything takes your whole turn. But you can't do it because there's just not enough time. There's enough time for Tessin to replay the War Leader comfortably before anything is even a consideration. Options. And now he's got the option of running both minions into Gadget Zen just to clear it off, or he can do some other stuff with the Pyro if he really needs to, but I don't think that's going to be the option here. Probably going to be a Doomsayer.
Doomsayer looks awesome. Situation.
Two mana, buy yourself a turn. Seems pretty good, and you know...
There is, of course, the possibility of sap on the Doomsayer. Especially now with the second sap picked up, we might actually see a push for to reclaim control of the board. Otherwise, if you just pass your turn, you give the initiative to the Paladin player again, and he's just going to drop Tyrone. And
so how do you like Fan Sap Van Cleef here? Ooh, it's unfortunate not to get the backstab first.
Yeah, it seems to be the only order you always draw it in, right? Like, you always draw backstab out of the fan.
Yeah. It's so frustrating.
Every time.
Okay, so he's not going to bother with the sap, deciding that he can wait and there are bigger targets to deal with. And there is the last Murloc. This is actually so scary. Turn 8 Tyrion to deal with. Turn 9, I'm pretty sure the Murloc will be played because there's at least one anything.
Yeah, I don't think Stansivka... It's fine to... actually leave the Doomsayer, let the Doomsayer proc, and just because you can still take control of the board right now by sapping the Tyrion and playing minions alongside the sap.
So now you go for Van Cleef, right?
Unless you're expecting a big clear, you can definitely go for the Van Cleef here.
Well, I just feel like a 3-4 and a 1-1 is not enough.
To
put any pressure on whatsoever. 4 damage means nothing when the Paladin's on 25 after the weapon hits. So I like the Van Cleef here just to put a bit of a threatening board out there and try and make Tessin answer. And he does have the answer as well as the Bluegill. So he can work it all in this turn.
Yeah, I don't doubt that we're going to see this. It's such a good clear. And setting up the anything perfectly.
And the thing is as well, the first anything won't do it. But once the first one's played, one, Sifka has to deal with the board. Then he'll be constantly terrified of the second anything.
Well,
so you just put you put your opponent in such a bad position that they just cannot deal with it.
He won't be terrified of it because he knows like the second anything is going to kill him. So he's not even going to play around it. There's like
I'm not saying it's you can play around it. It's just frustrating when you see the first one, especially with all four Murlocs. You're like, okay, well, if he has the next one, I'm just dead anyway.
Yeah, it's
just frustrating more than anything.
Stansivka's got to know by the time he's on that he will be on borrowed time, basically, right? He has to finish before the second anything comes down.
And he knows there's still Tyrion in there as well after the sap, so he does have a second sap. Is there a world in which you sap the Murloc? Probably not when you know Tyrion's in hand, because then just Tyrion Murloc is fantastic turn anyway. So Sifka having a...
Yeah, at this point, Sifka's only hope might be really to just hope that there's no anything, that both anythings are still in the deck.
Yeah. And it's not even, like, a conceal, you know, so he can set up just a crazy... He's got a double Cold Blood Leeroy, Evis, but there's no conceal to try and build that up. So that'll be, what, 18 damage from that combo. And I don't think... Has he already used an Eviscerate? I don't think so.
No, I don't think so either.
Because he still has multiple coins, so you could actually at one point like Leeroy Evis, Cold Blood Evis, you know, and go for a crazy amount of burst. But we do see the anything come down, and now it is only going to be a matter of time for Sifka.
Interesting here, he could he already traded against the Tomb Pillager. He could run the 1-1 and the other Murloc into the Acidic Swampus in order to draw 2 cards off of the Solemn Vigil. Oh, but yeah, I don't understand why he.
It does the 1-1 matter?
Yeah, especially the 1-1 doesn't matter
at all. The Solemn Vigil as well. All you need is the second Enafin to win this game.
Yeah, yeah.
So why not draw two more cards?
Yeah, I don't get it at all. Yeah. Like, what's the 1-1 going to accomplish?
Yeah, I feel like that is a slip up there from Tessin. He's still in a very good position, of course, but now there's a conceal. So now things could get interesting. He's still under a lot of damage, but like you said, Sifka cannot play as if that second Enafin exists. Because what's the point? You're dead. And that's just the way it is. So is this a turn where you try and go for Leeroy? You just Leeroy, cold blood, hit, conceal, and just hope? There's not a lot you can do, right?
It might very well be. After all, like we said, after the first Enafin, we know Stansivka knows he's on borrowed time. Mm-hmm. He has this sense of urgency now that he has to go for
the and a lack of any other minion means Leeroy's all he's got to work with.
Exactly. He doesn't have time to let Tessin draw into the second Enafin. It's just impossible. He has to go for this Leeroy right now.
And he has the sap for the Tyrion as well, if the Enafin isn't there.
That's right. It's obviously a good play by Stansivka, but however, we see that this will be answered with ease by the Pyromancer, Solemn Vigil, and Forbidden Healing. Yeah. Hey, maybe in hindsight, this was actually the right play to keep the second spell. But of course, it definitely would have drawn.
Yeah, I mean, like the Solemn Vigil also could have just drawn you.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, it's like guaranteed a win.
Yeah.
You don't play around presuming that Leeroy's going to come out with a conceal to try and win the game. So. I think the Forbidden Healing here, especially after seeing two Cold Bloods, setting your opponent to three, Forbidden Healing is going to seal the deal. It's now there. He's only spells in hand. A couple of coins. Preparation, a sap, and a Viz is not what you need to do 22 damage to Paladin one turn.
Unfortunately, we didn't see the prep coin seed.
Oh,
I always
nice.
Like to see that, but yeah.
The prep coin seed.
Stansivka not giving it to us. No. But yeah, Stansivka now in a similar position as he was in the previous series against Life Coach. 0-2 behind, but of course, then he was able to reverse sweep with his first pick deck.
Yeah, his priest.
And
what's kind of funny is priest isn't too terrible against Murlocs.
You
know what? Priest isn't great versus Murloc as long as the Murloc player knows how to play the match, right? Because you have to kill your Murlocs every time you play them. Because if they get entombed, you suddenly run into a lot of problems.
Yeah, but now the Murloc Paladin Mirror. This is always going to be interesting.
Have you played a lot of this?
I feel like I should play more of it. Mm-hmm. I felt like I did play a bunch of Murloc Paladin, but I never really got to face the mirror while practicing. So when I played against JJ in the group phase, I felt like I just didn't know.
I didn't have the experience.
Yeah, I didn't. Yeah. I felt like I didn't know what I'm doing, even though like in theory I had the right plates in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's very tricky. It can be very tricky at times. Yeah, a lot of people struggle with it because it's like such a different concept of gameplay when it comes compared to other matchups, right?
Yeah, I'll tell you what I've discovered about the matchup is that the idea mainly revolves around when you play your Murlocs in terms of giving you opportunities to have their Murlocs buffed, but mainly who plays the Enafin first is one of the big questions. And what I've discovered is if you're not in fear, not that this is a crazy genius idea, by the way, but if you're not in fear of dying to the return Enafin, playing it first is always correct.
Definitely.
Because then, if you have the second one,
yeah,
of course. Because then they can never play their Enafin, so they can never really win. If you play the first one and not die to the return swing, then you can't really lose.
The most important key to this matchup, and Stansivka sees it right there, is to go aggressive, right?
Yeah. You have to. Yeah, you put them low.
You have to be the smork. You have to be the aggro. You have to be the aggro player in this mirror matchup, because the lower you put your opponent, the more likely it is that your Enafin can actually kill him.
Exactly. Yeah. Right? And you remove the option that the return Enafin doesn't kill you, right? If you put your opponent really low and the backswing Enafin can potentially kill them, then that's the situation you want to be in, so they can't return fire. But it looks like
the best thing that can happen is basically if you don't even have to rely on your Murlocs, right? So if you just
play beatdown.
So if you just if you just play beatdown with all your non-Murloc resources, and Tyrion is like a really amazing card in this matchup because of the Ashbringer providing so much damage in general to the face.
It's really awkward damage because you know your opponent is potentially capable of even just 12 damage burst, then suddenly your heals become very awkward as well because you've got to keep yourself out of range at all times. And I'm pretty sure both these players will be making notes on what Murlocs applied on each side as well, because Murloc math is something you definitely need to learn. So now, excuse me, it does look like Sivka is ahead in terms of the beatdown game, so to speak, but the Doomsayer is going to try and put a stop to that as Tessin drops it there. So not too bad at all, even doing the hero power to help with the potential Solemn Vigil, which is going to look okay. Wild Pyro now, nothing too great that can actually kill off. Well, do you ever want a True Silver into this Doomsayer? I feel like you're using too much.
It feels so bad, and it's not like you value this Pyromancer as much. So I wouldn't blame him for just sacrificing his Pyromancer.
Yeah, I like this. And True Silver has much. True Silver can actually just help race for a start,
exactly.
And put, you know, it's 8 damage. That's a lot when you only have 30 max.
Yeah, you see this very often actually. That True Silver will just go face to pressure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And of course, it's also a very smooth answer to any like mid game minions.
Most minions actually in the Paladin deck, other than the big guys, like other than like Rag and Tyrion, it actually just deals with most of the minions that are available. So I like holding on to True Silver here. And now looks like Sivka's got a few more things to think about.
I actually am not sure. I tried to look up the decklist just now, but didn't find the Paladin that Stan Sivka and most likely JJ as well are playing. But I don't think there actually is the Tyrion and the Ragnaros in the list.
Really?
Yeah, they had like JJ had like Harrison against me, for example.
Okay.
And yeah.
That seems crazy to not play Tyrion.
And Leon Hands as well.
Oh, yeah. Because yesterday we saw JJ's Lay on Hands. Yeah, that's a good point, actually. We didn't see Tyrion. To me, that feels crazy. Because I just feel like Tyrion goes in every Paladin deck. just because the guy's so strong.
Yeah, but Tyrion is... like I said, Tyrion is like one of the most important cards in this matchup. Just because it represents so much damage.
And now we see the fun interaction here. Sivka makes the choice to just smork. And it's like, thanks for the War Leader. Because now Blue Girl just goes face. He gets the extra damage, then kills off the War Leader. So then his opponent can't gain the same reverse attack. Excuse me. This used to be even more proficient when Old Murkai was a card. Because he was buffed by every Murloc on the board. So that used to be an even more important sort of thing to think about.
So what does Ivory Knight pick up? I'm pretty sure we can assume that Hammer of Wrath is going to be a pretty good pickup here.
Does Sacred Trial work versus anything?
What did it say exactly after you summon your third minion?
Maybe. I think it says played, actually.
Yeah.
So I guess not, because they're all summoned, right? Be interesting to know, though. I think it won't, but it would be crazy if it did, because that's a serious thing to think about then.
Yeah.
Eye for an eye. Not too bad, although Seal of Champions helps with just like the, sort of more smoke damage, I guess. And Eye for an Eye, you can't guarantee it because they're not late enough in the game to see an anything be played. So you can't really guarantee a big hit from one of the Murlocs into your opponent. So I like Seal of Champions here, to be honest.
Yeah, Seal of Champions also gives your minion some sort of resilience that you target it with, in case you're expecting to get AoE'd. So your opponent would need like one more damage source to finish off that buffed minion.
Mm-hmm. This is nothing feels great here for Tessin. I'm gonna be honest. Everything just feels a little.
I've kind of lost track about the Murlocs. How many Murlocs died right now?
I think it's just one War Leader, one Blue Girl,
okay,
as far as I'm aware.
Yeah, so far only those. Because it's always obviously it's always so important to keep track about how many Murlocs total have died.
Yep.
Yeah, you have to count yours. You have to count your opponent.
Oh, okay. So he can choose to kill off the Ivory Knight with the Bluegill, sorry. But then you have to think about, and then as you just said, you'll make a note, okay, 2 Bluegill Warriors, 1 War Leader now. So it's definitely something to keep in mind. And it depends what the game plan is for each of these guys, because I feel like we've seen Tessin be more open with his Murlocs than we've seen Sivka. Because Sivka did the trade, right, with the first Bluegill as like a response and then killed off the War Leader. Whereas Tessin was the one who put the first War Leader down, I believe. Although it's very easy to lose track in this mirror.
Yeah. So now we do see the Leon hands, but of course it would overdraw if he. Would it? No, it wouldn't overdraw.
It would overdraw next turn, right? Because he can't play anything else. Unless he forbidden healings for nothing.
Oh, yeah, it would. Exactly. It would overdraw. Wow, that is a weak. That is a really weak.
Comp spirit for the anything. Do it.
Yeah, I don't think that will be ever relevant. We might even see Blessing of Might here because Redemption doesn't find many good targets in Stansifka's deck. If there is no Tyrion, yeah, we can see right here. If he had Tyrion, he probably would have gone for that Redemption to have a nice setup for the Tyrion.
Which would be insane, actually. Now, looks like Tessin, who is playing the Tyrion and Ragnaros package, has his choice between the two big 8-drop guys.
Yeah, generally
I think I always just like Tyrion.
Yeah, generally it's always better to go for Tyrion first because then you can, trade off minions. And it's pretty much always the rule of thumb in any kind of matchup, right? You play the Tyrion first, so you get the Ashbringer immediately, start swinging with it into minions potentially, and then you can heal yourself up after swinging into minions.
Yeah, I think the frustration here with Tyrion is that there's a 1-1 on the board, so the Divine Shield is very easy to proc.
Okay.
Whereas, like, if you saw like the 1-1 trade, and then the Ivory Knight and Consecrate, then it's like, you didn't have to work hard to kill that Tyrion. So I don't mind the Ragnaros in this instance, just because you know the Divine Shield is very, very easily dealt with.
Yeah, but the thing is, do you really mind Tyrion dying? That is the question, because you do want that Ashbringer as well.
Yeah, that's true, but you don't also have a lot of good opportunities to play Rag.
Oh, wow, look at this. Stansifka going
this is a big horsey. Going straight to face for the
10-1. Did you see how surprised Destin looked? He's like, what the hell is this?
Wasn't expecting that.
And
wow.
Furthermore, how do I deal with this? It's
well played. Oh, there's the shake of the head. He's got no good way to deal with this.
He can't believe it. He's like, yeah, that's a 10-1 Divine Shield. What the hell?
And at the moment, without Wild Pyro, he can't kill it.
Well,
he has to follow up with Tyrion and hope.
Yeah, well, to be fair, Tyrion will put a stop to this.
Yeah, but what if there's no good way to actually deal the one damage? What if Sifka can deal one damage to the shield and then just trade and there's still 10-1 on the board and no AoE.
Yeah, right now he is even anticipating it maybe. Put your faith
in the light. You don't want to face tanker 10-1 with an Ashbringer, that's for sure. And now do you just trade? And oh no, he has the Enfin. Enfin's pretty strong actually. Yeah, I like
and
it.
We do see Tessin does not have the anything of it.
And even if he did, he wouldn't die to it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Stansifka still has such a high amount of health.
And this is the key now. I mean, this is just game.
Yeah, pretty much.
This is just game. There's nothing to come
out. His Ivory Knight did some serious work.
What a hero. The 10... I just love the fact it's been a quality. Because it's just a 10-1 Divine Shield card. Like, what is this? That has to be Pyro.
Yeah. But it doesn't matter, right?
No, but you have to presume the second Enderfin's not there, right? You play to survive at this point, but I think Tessin pretty much knew pretty early on that the shake of the head was the enough for that, and he is going to concede. And what a wonky game. We were like, yeah, so this is how the matchup generally goes. Or you build a massive horse and hit him in the face with Divine Shield.
Yeah, that was definitely unconventional. Usually, generally not the picks you typically see out of Ivory Knight, right?
Yeah.
But in this matchup, in this particular case, it worked out perfectly.
Yeah, and I think we said quite early on, a lot of the times you just try and beat down, go aggressive, and force your opponent into an awkward moment. And yeah, 10-1 to the face normally does that.
I still honestly would have liked Tyrion over the Ragnaros first. Mm-hmm. It probably wouldn't have changed much in the grand scheme, but it's a bit.
At least then you would threaten the Ashbringer, right? You know, like as some form of damage. And now Tessin's going to have to put some work in to beat out Sifka's Murloc Paladin as the match is 2-1. Sorry, and Tessin is gone with its Hunter. And I actually like this matchup as the Hunter. I feel you can be so relentless with the damage, and also a lot of the minions are very janky to deal with for the Paladin. Nothing's the clays don't ever feel clean.
Yeah, Tessin's Hunter deck is very unconventional. He does run double Explosive Trap, and he also has the N'Zoth as far as I know.
Yeah, I think he is running N'Zoth. And that could actually help him out, to be honest, in this matchup. Paladin doesn't normally kill you very quickly, And if you can Nuzoth back, even just a Nuzoth plus a single high main, and the odds on him playing Death Rattles before that, we can already see this Fiery Bat and kind of Grandmother in hand. So, you know, building up the full board again for a 10-man in Nuzoth, as long as you're not instantly dead to anything, is going to feel pretty damn good for Tessin if that's what happens in this game.
Yeah, the explosive trip, on the other hand, is not going to prove to be useful at all in this matchup generally.
Yeah, I think the only benefit is it's more damage to push. Cause at some point, the paladin's hitting face, right? You're not going to, you know, literally OTK the hunter. So at least there's something there, as it's going to put in a little bit more damage. But yeah, obviously, definitely not optimal to play explosive trap against this deck. So already. And the kind of grandmother down and the bat. And we see it. So Eagle Horn and Bow onto the 1-1 could be a thing here. You want to defend your kind of grandmother. Yeah. That's the key one. And if he didn't have a play to kill this 1-1, I imagine he'd actually have gone with the bat trade and just left the 1-1 alive, because you really want to make these clears as awkward as possible. Doomsayer, not a bad pickup. And he could actually follow up if the so three, four, there's only 6 damage, so it would need an additional burn from the Hunter or a Houndmaster to deal with. And he can follow up with Bluegill if the Grandmother dies to kill off the 3-2.
But this is definitely the right call here with Doomsayer. On board, there's nothing that deals with it. Mm-hmm. On board, you can't deal with it immediately. So Stansivka, so Tessin has to commit a card to it.
And also it stops there because unless it was Quick Shot, which would have been much better for Tessin, this kill command means that there's no hero power this turn. And I do feel like unless you're literally playing full on curve minions, you try and really just weave in as many hero powers as possible. Because already Stansivka's on 21 and there's still the 2 minions with pressure. And we can see the second bow plus hero power available next turn, and then straight into high main with the Call of the Wild as a planned finisher, I guess.
Mm. With the Eaglehorn bow gone, I wouldn't be surprised to see Murloc Warrior in this situation. But yeah, we do see the second Eaglehorn bow ready to go, ready to kill off this Murloc Warrior already in Tessin's hand.
Yeah, and it feels like as Hunter, everything you're going to draw is great. Like, you know, versus Paladin. Like, any minion, especially from, like, turn 5 onwards, is pretty much playable. Unless you, you draw into the Nuzoth or whatever.
Or Explosive Trap.
True. I said any minion drawn.
You're right.
1-1 now. We've evened it up. Okay. But even, like, a second Call of the Wild. Okay, I can't play it yet. But great. You know, like, that's fine. So, almost
that's
any...
not a minion either.
Well, no, but you decided to start talking about spells. So, come on, I'll keep up. The second Call of the Wild isn't terrible. Infested Wolf, again, just awkward to deal with. And even now, the 1-1 goes into the... it's going to trade the Grandmother in first. Okay. I suppose the 1 damage doesn't make too much of a difference. And it does stop the 1-1 getting buffed by a potential Keeper. But even this, again, just super awkward to deal with.
Yeah, this time
it's
it was
such a pain.
This time it was actually good to attack into the 1-1 and have the better minion pop out of the kindly grandmother. So he applies much pressure. Of course, if he was going to go for the clear, the infested wolf would drop some spiders. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was still like one. At least having one good death rattle minion on board against the potential board clear is always going
to
be good.
Yeah, and not too much of a thought. To be honest, if you can jam high main on 6 in almost any situation you do, but especially versus this Paladin list. And we see Tessin really starting to stack up the pressure now. There's been a relatively decent 6 heal from that Ivory Knight. And this is the problem, and this is why I feel Hunter does so well. Like, enter Colosseum, great. But then you have so many tokens left on the board, and then you have to go into Consecration next turn. But in that, then it means that the attacks have gone in from the tokens, and the Hunter's played something else.
I feel like we might actually see... Oh, this is tricky.
Would you have a quality trade consecrate? Then you just leave the one ones.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
The one ones from the wolf. You trade in time.
Yeah.
Unless you want to leave 2/2s up, Peacock. I mean, if it was me, I would leave the one ones, but, you know. Oh, okay.
Oh, he decided to go for a Colosseum.
Leave high main up.
Yeah, well, the thing is, if you use your equality now, you won't have equality later on for the Calls of the Wild. Oh, my goodness.
Tessin must be feeling fantastic at this moment in time, because these draws have been exactly what you need. Just on curve, constant pressure from the Hunter, and now double call with a kill command to throw him whenever he feels like for extra burn. It's going to be feeling great. The Aldor Peacekeeper coming off the top there for Sivka. which is going to reduce the high main down to one if he feels he can squeeze it in. But
yeah, he really needed Alder Peacekeeper last turn for the high main, so he could, like,
you wouldn't have been able to clear though.
He would have put down the high main to one attack, mm-hmm. and then be able to clear the infested wolf and the kindly grandmother with the consecration, like attack into the wolf and then consecrate.
He wouldn't have had the mana.
Oh yeah, right.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Mana right, like, now. Yeah,
exactly. So the Aldor would have been good, but you still take a lot of damage because you didn't clear. So
yeah,
it's just it's always an awkward situation. And now there's just Call the Wild, clear it if you want, Call the Wild again. And now Zivka did value the Forbidden Healing for 14. And now, you know.
Yeah, that is just the power of Hunter being able
to
curve
out
perfectly.
It's so good.
When a Hunter does curve out against a control deck, it's really powerful.
Just relentless. Absolutely relentless.
The thing is, why it's so powerful against control is because the minions are so... Sure, they're clunky at times. Mm-hmm. When you compare them to other aggressive decks, the minions are really clunky that you play on curve. But against control decks, you want those minions to be clunky because they represent such a high amount of power. And yeah, sure, you struggle in the aggro matchup, but this is what Hunter is made for, basically, the mid-range
Hunter. Exactly, yeah.
You're supposed to crush those control decks with the Hunter.
And you just see a perfect example, like Equality Kunk, the clear that you want in the deck to just should wipe the board. Hang on, there's still 4 power, plus the Hunter Hero power, plus the bow still active, and God knows what left in Tessin's hand. So how much damage is that, actually? Is that just game?
Yes.
I think it is. Well, yeah,
exactly,
there we go. And the Hunter just textbook game there from Tessin. He drew extremely well.
Wow.
Played it very solid, but there wasn't much to even go wrong there, I feel. And yeah, clears up Stan Zivka. So another huge name. Just, you know, just ticked off for Tessin.
Yeah,
not too bad at all. This could be his tournament. What do you think, Lothar? Ah, okay, never mind. We'll talk to you in a minute when your mic's on.
This definitely is Tessin's tournament already. I mean, what more can you say? It's like Tessin does kick out one big name after another, and it's just like,
as you said,
he's just having this dominant run.
Yeah, he had before a 3-1, 3-1, 3-0, and it's another 3-1.
Yeah.
Right. So he's performing really
well. Look at the names
really
he's against. It's not like he's playing against pushovers.
He's knocking everyone, actually, like pushing over everyone to the lower bracket, and now he will be playing in the grand final tomorrow, which is quite amazing, I would say. Right. He has the chance to have the really great advantage. The winner's bracket.
Yeah. The winner's final. Yeah.
The winner's bracket final, and if he wins that, he has a huge advantage in the entire grand final. We have still the best matches, best plays of the match. We'll see in a few seconds. It's getting really.
And we're going to be seeing a lot of Murlocs in this, I believe.
Exactly.
and that mirror though, I really liked the way Zivka played the mirror with the Ivory Knight pulling off like the buff cards and just going aggressive. It ended up with a 10-1 Divine Shield Ivory Knight going face and no way for Tessin to deal with it. Yeah. So that was a super cool mirror to watch.
He definitely knew how to navigate this matchup particularly, and it worked out perfectly.
Yeah. But I'm here.
Okay, so here we go.
And we're back.
The best plays of the game were me and Ecop. There we go. That's all you needed to see, guys. Oh,
here we go.
Never. Oh, okay, thanks, production. to shoot me down. Okay, so the clear onto the rogue there looks pretty good and just started stacking up just too much damage to deal with. And this is where we see Zivka pretty much only have one option here, where he had to go to Leeroy. He did draw the conceal, but it was a little bit too late because he didn't have any other minions but Leeroy to try and go all in with. But as we can see, Tessin actually had the easy or relatively easy clear, which just ended the game, especially because one of the tools he used to clear was the Forbidden Healing.
Yep. Actually, that was a really pretty play, but unfortunately it's not good
enough. He drew Consecrate. Yeah. I forgot about that.
I mean, he had the Pyromancer.
Exactly,
so
he could have cleared before he even drew the Consecrate anyway.
Exactly. So
and this is so good. Look at this horse.
And Tessin's reaction to that was just incredible.
I'm pretty sure he was just like, GG, okay, good game. There's not a lot you can really answer to that.
We have Tessin, congratulations. You are wrecking people. What do you have to say?
Thanks a lot. Yeah, like, this is just the format I like. Like, there's so many possibilities, and you really need to consider everything. Like, you won't lose to someone who's playing 3 aggro decks in Conquest or something like that. Mm-hmm. You actually have the opportunity to outplay your opponent. And in a match like this against Stan Zivka, it's really hard because he's playing so many tech cards. I was writing everything down, but I didn't play around a 10-1 horse with the Divine Shield.
It was so good.
Well, that's the power of discovery, right? you can have something out of the books, and like suddenly you have to stand against something like that. It's a monstrosity, right? 10-1 Divine Shield. But anyway, that's not really that important. You had really consistent results. The group stage, 3-1 and 3-1, you went through as the winner. Now you have two matches. One was a sweep against Xixo, right?
3-0. Yes.
And now a 3-1 against Stan Sivka. So only really big names that you're crushing. That's quite an achievement itself. So it seems like you're doing pretty well. And now you will be playing in the winner's bracket final. And if you win that, you're in the grand final with an advantage. So I hope you pull it off and be in the grand final.
Yeah, for sure. Like, it worked out pretty good. I prepared so much for this. And mm-hmm. the first thing I'm going to do when I get home is preparing for tomorrow. Like, writing down every situation. What am I going to ban? What am I going to pick? And
Did you think about the... well, you just finished this, so probably not. But you'll be playing against JJ tomorrow, right? So what is your experience? Did you play against JJ before? Like,
yeah,
a lot?
He was my first match in this tournament. Mm-hmm. And I think it's all about the ban pick situation. And now I can see his deck list, and that will help a lot for sure. But
did it change a lot in the top 8 for you? If that you know the exact deck list?
Yeah, for sure. Like that. Okay, against Sixo, I knew his deck list before the game. Mm-hmm. But yeah, like, it's doing everything about which decks do you let open. Like, do you ban mage? I banned mage because it was freeze mage. Normally, I don't care about tempo mage. My decks can beat that without a problem. Mm-hmm. But since I saw the freeze mage, okay, I can't handle that. Never mind. And
okay.
Then I banned it.
Well, fortunately, the format is really giving an advantage to the players that have a game plan. So good to see that people are prepared. And basically, that's it for today. We have day 3 of the entire tournament still. That will be happening tomorrow, of course. And we have just a few matches. The first match will be actually JJ against Essen, if I'm not mistaken. Hoy against Lifecode. My mistake, my bad. It's getting late, guys. So... thank you very much for watching. This was day 2 of PGL Tavern Tales, and we'll see tomorrow at 10:30 a.m. local time, which is GMT+2. So, see you guys tomorrow.